After a grueling practice at the Muay Thai Lao Kickboxing Academy in Sacramento, California, I had the opportunity to stay after class and talk with the head instructor, Mr. A.K. King. I was primarily curious about the differences between Muay Thai and Muay Lao, and he had a lot of interesting things to share with me. Check it out.
This is Christopher Kennedy again. I'm coming at you this time out of Sacramento, California. Today I'm at the Muay Thai Lao Kickboxing Academy with my newest friend, A.K. King.
How's it going?
Good. So, last week has been great, by the way.
Thank you.
You have some really great students, really great instruction. I've learned a lot of really good stuff.
I'm really appreciating you coming out here and hanging out with us. Like I said, this environment, we try to keep it more like a family environment. So whoever comes in, we try to help get whatever you need to get you ready for your battle somewhere else. You know, as long as we can help you, that's a plus for us.
Thank you. So, A.K. King's not your real name though, right?
A.K. is my initial, that's my fight name. My buddy Ty Elliott called me A.K. Because a lot of people can't pronounce my name a lot. My name's Anthem. And my
is
last
that Laotian name?
Yeah, that's a Laos name. I think it is, but I hope so. And my last name is Gong Kong. It means a pile of gold. It means something. A Laos and Thai name, it has meaning behind it. You know? Ampon is like blessing or some kind of blessing. I forgot what they told me, but that's a long time ago.
That's cool.
Yeah, so Ampon started with the A, and my last name started with the K, so they put that together, and that was my fight name, became A.K. So ever since then, I just stick with A.K., you know, and everybody
like
called me A.K.
And A.K.?
Yeah, because when I was training for a while, and I was just non-stop, so they're like, you are A.K., you got so many rounds in you, you know? I'm like, oh, thanks, I'm going to use that A.K. name forever.
I like that.
Yeah.
Pause for just a sec. Maybe we can turn off the music?
Yeah,
just so this is going.
Or you can just turn the knob down. And we can turn the back.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, perfect, perfect. That'll sound much better. So A.K., there's not a whole lot of Laotian gyms I've noticed in the United States. In fact, this was the only Laotian gym I could find, or that claims to be a Laotian gym.
Yeah, there's a couple, because a lot of our people is really not well known, you know?
I see.
And we are like, I guess you would say, the bottom of certain area. And there's Laos art everywhere, but it just usually in different gym stuff, you know.
I see.
Some trainers are Laos. Most of them I know is Laos.
But they just call them Thai.
Or there's a couple of people I know from East Coast. There's more Lao there.
Oh,
They're
cool.
Coming up. And there's some up in Washington is coming up. It's kind of blooming, you know.
Okay.
Because our
good.
People is coming and showing more of our traditional and technique and art also. It's the same as Muay Thai. Like I told you before, Muay is just the art of where it comes from. You know, the art, like saying West Muay America, that would be Western boxing. Muay, you know, Muay Thai, Muay Khmer, Muay Burmese. Muay is just the art for that culture or that place, what you want to put it.
I see.
It's the art of.
Okay. So Muay Lao would just translate into like the art of
Muay Lao.
Laos?
Yeah, the martial art of Laos. That would have been how you would say it, or martial art of Cambodia, martial art of Thai, or Lao boxing, or Thai boxing, right?
Right.
Or Burmese boxing. Muay is just the word for those.
I see.
You know, the art of what they use, you know, the form of martial art and stuff like that.
I see.
It's not very a lot because a lot of time I guess they don't want to show too much.
Oh.
And when I was training at the age of 16, my teacher didn't even want to show it to me.
Oh.
Because usually certain art, certain traditionally, it pass on to their kids and stuff like that. And I was lucky enough that he taught me, you know, and I was the outsider. I was not even part of his family, you know? So I was happy enough he taught me something like that, and then I want to open a Muay Lao in the future, at least just to show people, you know, there's no different, it's similar, you know?
Yeah.
You kick, you knee, you elbow, you punch. Same thing.
Yeah.
It just depend on who teaches, who's the coach, you know? Like they say, there's no bad student, right?
Right.
If your students are bad, that's because you got a bad coach.
That's right. Mr. Miyagi says.
Exactly. Exactly. It's the same. I mean, traditionally, I try to teach people here as much as I can, but a lot of time is America. I don't want to say like we're spoiled here, you know?
Mm.
We pretty much have everything handed to us. In Laos and Thailand, we have to work hard for it. You want to train? You come in and train. You do the same thing over and over until you get it. Here, everybody want to get it quick. You know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, Muay Lao is blooming right now. I would say like my friend Andrew from Mid East area and Jason, Florida. Some of those guys on Facebook doing all Muay Lao. And there's a lot of other fighters coming up representing Muay Lao, or they're representing their coach in Muay Khmer, you know?
Oh,
but
cool.
They train the same as Muay Thai.
Hmm.
I got one of my buddies that just fought a while back, I think it was recently, beginning of this year, he was Khmer.
Oh.
But he was married to a Laos girl.
Hmm.
So he represented Laos and Khmer.
Oh.
You know?
Yeah.
So then he was like Muay Khmer, Muay Lao, Muay Thai. So cool. Really, he's representing all three. Just like us here, we like, yeah, Muay Thai, Muay Lao. So we're representing Muay Thai as the art, and also our art, Muay Lao. You know?
Awesome, yeah.
So it's just not a different coach. It's really the same.
I see. So your instructor was Laotian, correct?
Yeah, my teacher is Laotian. His name is Nguyen Phuong Savan. He's very old now. Like, he wouldn't even hold pads for you. He'll tell you what you need to do.
Oh.
He'll have you kick stuff, and he says, that's wrong. He'll just come tap you on the shoulder, you're doing it wrong. He's one of those guys, you know?
I see.
He's been doing it for a while. He fought a couple of times. Every time I ask him, he tell me the same story over and over, which is like he's a war veteran, so everything is repeat over and over.
Oh.
So he tells me the same thing over and over. He tells me what he likes to do, how he would like to use his technique for, and you know, a lot of time he won't use it for violence because he's seen it already.
I see.
So he taught me to learn how to protect myself because I guess he knows that I was one of those knucklehead kids that likes, I don't like to pick problems, but I always get into a lot of, you would say, into a bad situation where you have to fight your way out.
I see.
I was one of those kids, I guess. Yeah.
And you were 16 when you started training with him?
Yeah. I know the family since I was like 13.
Okay.
I've been hanging around with them. I've seen them train, and I always wanted to train, but they wouldn't want to teach me. So
How did you convince them?
I just keep on coming and coming, like a nonstop. I just like, hey, could I train today? Hey, what are we having for dinner? just more like, you know, be one of those like cousins that always keep coming over the house and hang out with you. I was one of those guys, and I just keep coming and coming, and basically pretty soon they were like, you know what? Maybe you look like you have it in you, you know? So they kind of show me a little bit basic, how to stand, how to move my feet, how to get my guard up, basic stuff, elbows and all, you know, all the basic what you need to learn the first time. And then after that, pain.
Pain?
Which means like conditioning.
Like conditioning?
Yeah. Then I went from basic to learning how to condition, which means like you need to learn how to get stronger, faster, how to take punches, how to take hits, how to understand those, you know?
Yeah.
What happens if you don't have cardio? You will get tired. What happens if you don't have the strength? You will get tired, right? And what happens if you can't handle getting hit? You will get tired and get beat up, basically. So I have to understand all those things, and it takes a while, so I have to basic thing to the condition. Then after that, once he knows that I can handle it, then we move on to a little bit more difficult technique.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Have you ever tried any other martial arts?
I have. When I finished school, I just turned 18 and I left to Texas, which my dad stays over there. I was looking for a gym out there, Fort Worth, Texas, and they didn't have no gym. They didn't have what I wanted, like kickboxing. I was looking for more like kickboxing.
Right.
They didn't have that there. They had like karate and then taekwondo. So you know what? That's when Muay Thai was out in the open.
I see.
It's just karate, taekwondo, kickboxing, just barely coming on too. But if there was, I didn't find it. Not where I was at. But so I said, you know what? If Bruce Lee kicked fast, maybe I should go do some taekwondo. That's what I thought. You know, I thought Bruce Lee know taekwondo. So I thought, you know what? I'm going to do taekwondo. So went there, got my leg fast, but it was totally different because I did karate before I was in the process of doing Muay Thai. Mm-hmm. I did karate when I was 14, before my teachers started teaching me.
Right.
But karate wasn't my, I guess, forte or special.
I see.
I didn't get, not because it wasn't bad or anything like that, it was just like the way they were taught me, I wouldn't really get it down. Like, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on the coach who teach you. So when I took taekwondo, most likely I was one-on-one with my coach.
Oh.
And he was just teaching me what I need to do. So I was like, I like this better, you know?
Right.
Because he's watching me. Because if I act up, he's going to make me do push-up or squat for hours or something, you know? So I didn't want to get in trouble. So I just do what he asked. Yeah. So I got pretty good at that. I competed. I fought three guys. I thought it was going to be one of those, you know, like I told you before, like those point kickboxing and you score a point. It wasn't like that. It was like a minute or so and you go at it with this guy. But there's a lot of time when we're hands are down. We just kick a lot.
Oh, interesting.
And I was just out kicking the other guy, you know? So I won over three guys, a gold medal.
Awesome.
Which is good. I got
gold medals are good.
Yeah. That's the other martial I did besides Muay Thai.
So what about Muay Lao or Muay Thai really attracted you? Why did you choose it over karate or taekwondo? Like, why aren't you teaching a karate or taekwondo class right now?
I mean, like, I would show people taekwondo kick to be aware of those because there's a lot of people that knows taekwondo kicks and karate. Mm-hmm. I would show people how, like, if you're running to a karate guy, this is what they're going to be standing like and this is how they're going to be fighting like.
I see.
Then this is how you're going to protect yourself from it.
Okay.
Taekwondo, I teach them a little bit because that's, like I said, taekwondo is what I did to get my leg and my kicks faster. That's what I believe, but it might be something else for everybody else. So I got a couple of my taekwondo students here that's a black belt, but they never did Muay Thai.
Mm.
But they always get beat up by Muay Thai. So I show them how to convert taekwondo to use against Muay Thai or Muay Lao, you know, how they block. This is how Muay Lao block or Muay Thai block. This is where you need to aim for. But there's a couple pro champ out there that did taekwondo and won the fights, kickboxing also, and karate, you know. I don't say it's not bad. I just say you just got to know how to use it against something. You got to know how to use your weapon.
Mm-hmm.
So I would show people how to, a little bit of taekwondo here, not karate, but because I didn't learn that much. But then I show people how to mostly just Muay Lao.
I see.
You know, how, where to attack and how to attack.
And did you choose Muay Lao just because it's like your heritage or what did you?
One, yes. It's more like our bloodline. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have to really like put it out there like that's what I am and that's what our culture is.
Right.
You know, it's not a religion, it's our culture. That's our art, you know?
Right.
It's the same as Thailand. And at the same time, it's more realistic for me. And because they've been using it for a long time and they're still here, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And now Muay Thai is one of the
mostly used
in UFC and everywhere else that I could think of. And, you know, it's the most deadliest sport and more realistic that I can see. Besides, if you got no leg, then it would be boxing. And boxing is realistic. Mm-hmm. You're swinging, you know? You're going at it. And I mean, kickboxing is too, but Muay Thai, Muay Lao is more the form of made for war.
Hmm.
that's where it came, you know, to protect their country.
Yeah.
So it's not something, he's just finally made it for sport, you know, to compete with each other, to test each other out. But really it's made for defending your country, defending your home, defending your family. It's made for those things. It's made for war. That's why my teacher never, like I told you before, my teacher didn't want me to compete because he didn't believe in like going out there and more like showing off. You know, and he didn't want me to do that. So I had, I told him, I said, I just want to see, does it work for me, you know? So I did the Kai, I thanked Kai. And then he kind of blessed me, like, all right, you want to go test it out, fine, you know? So I came, that's when in 07 I met my friend Ty and kind of got back into training. First I just wanted to do conditioning, I didn't want to really fight, I just want to see like in sparring or if it works,
right?
You know, for me, you know, like what I learned, would it help me?
Right.
You know? So far it helped me.
Yeah.
And it got me to this point already, so I pretty much, that's why I choose Muay Thai, Muay Lao. But it's nothing wrong, but other martial art, I would love to use other martial art. Like, even, like I told you before, you have to be well-rounded.
Yeah.
You know, like wrestling, I got wrestling buddy comes in and show me wrestling. Jiu-jitsu, I got jiu-jitsu buddy come in and show me jiu-jitsu. It's great to know a lot, you know. Don't be one of those people that just in the camp. You're a sardine.
Yeah.
That's all you're going to be, right? Yeah. Open that can up, get out and, you know, see what's out there, you know. There's a lot of knowledge to take in. As a fighter, you have to know as much as you can.
Yeah.
Because definitely. As your coach, he's going to teach you that, right? But at the same time, he's the one outside of the ring.
That's true.
You're the one inside the ring with this guy, so you have to know whatever it takes to defend yourself, whatever it takes to counter, whatever, you know.
Yeah.
You have to know all that. That's why I said being open-minded is pretty, it's the right way to go for me, you know?
Yeah, awesome. Does Muay Lao have any sort of ranking system?
We do, but in my teacher, his ranking system is different. He just watch you, see how your form is, see how you kick, see how your strength is. He compared by that. You know, there is ranking system for certain martial art. Traditionally, I didn't get to all to that ranking system stuff.
I see.
All he mostly was teaching me is like how I would protect myself, how I would use it to defend myself against certain art or certain form or certain fight style, you know? What I need to look out for, you know?
Yeah.
Those kind of things. It's not like so much of a, back in the day, like in our culture, there was no ranking system.
Originally there wasn't none.
I don't think there was. They just watch you how much you grew by how what you learned, how much knowledge you took in.
I see.
You know? Their ranking system started probably from karate or taekwondo or some other.
Do you guys not use belts or anything like that?
No, we don't use belt. I mean, if you use the one that for farmers when they go out there and do the fields, but no, we don't have belt system. Armband is just the way of our coach is getting ready for war. He tight, he feel blessed, you know?
Oh.
He feel,
same with the headband or?
Yeah, the headband's being blessed by your teacher, by the monk to bless you, you know, to give you awareness and hopefully you helped you fight your battle.
Okay.
You know, it's a blessing from your teacher and your monk. So those are armbands that's made for.
I see.
It's not really a ranking system, but maybe I might be wrong. I might be wrong. I mean, Thai has a ranking system, armband.
But your instructor never bothered with that stuff, so.
No, because, like I said,
more traditional.
We're more traditional, but at the same time, more something that's gonna protect you and what's gonna work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I can wear an armband, but that what was that prove to me?
Nothing, I guess.
I mean, not to be bad with all the martial art. I'm just saying for myself and my experience. If I wear a black belt, I got a lot of people come here with a karate black belt and taekwondo. Still got their butt whooped.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of jiu-jitsu black belt. Not to say better than any other martial art, but they still got their butt whooped. So you have to understand, what if you're gonna use it for a fight and defend yourself, the ranking system
doesn't
really
doesn't matter.
Yeah,
I see that.
The ranking system for a lot of gym, a lot of martial art is to discipline their student. Mm-hmm. If they want to achieve something, then the ranking will be the best way to go for them to feel confident, build their confidence, build their self-esteem, build their goal and their achievement, self to look forward. That's why they made the ranking system. But for my teacher is what's going to work, why, and how, and when,
Yeah.
Those are the things that he's really care about. Traditionally, he want to make sure that all his students or all his families are well protected, that he don't need to worry about.
Yeah. So how do factors like age and gender affect Muay Lao training, or do they affect Muay Lao training?
Age and gender, it depends on, like, kids, if you bring kids in, like, three, I seen a kid that comes in here age of three and still know left and right. I see a kid comes here and age 13 and 12, still don't know their left and right.
Oh.
So it depends on the person itself,
I see.
Like,
individual.
Yeah,
more than the age.
Because as for me as their coach, I have to be aware of these things because there's some student that's just late bloomer.
Mm.
And there's some students just flow like the water.
I see. Yeah.
And like you see a couple of students. You spar one that was been here a year and 4 months with me, and you spar one that's been here for like 4 months.
Yeah.
And totally different. You wouldn't even tell
Completely
how long
different.
They've been
training,
But for me, as I can see how long they've been training.
Oh.
I can see the way they move. It's not smooth. Or the way they punch is off.
Hmm.
The way they kick is off. So I can tell who needed more improvement or who needs some kind of adjustment,
Okay.
So age has really nothing to do much with what you can learn, what you can absorb in.
Okay.
You can be like, I have a student that did with me a private lesson a while back named Tim. He's about 40 years old. And when he came and sparred the guy, they thought he was been doing it for like 2 years. And this is tall. I can see he's rough, very stiff, but he can handle himself with all these young guys that's been doing for a year more than him. And he's only been with me for like every other Saturday, every Sunday.
Oh, jeez.
So he was catching up quick for like an hour or two, because he wants to learn.
Yeah.
So I told him, I said, you're at the age where you have to think more, train harder, you gotta outsmart a young guy, Because as for an age like me, if I spar a guy, I have to outsmart him,
Yeah.
I can't use brute strength with a young guy that's trained 24 hours.
Mm.
You get what I'm saying? So age,
oh, yeah.
That's the only time age plays a different part.
I see.
But as age for learning, you don't play much of a different part. It depends on the person.
Makes sense, yeah.
Yeah, because the person can come in the same age as you and still won't pick up as fast as what you do.
Okay.
Yeah,
makes sense.
I got this guy. I got one of the students. I don't want to say his name, but he's been here a long time and he's still known. I got one guy. I got another guy came here, only been with me for a year, and he's already doing his first smoker and he already won his first fight.
Awesome.
So it depends on the person,
I see.
Yeah.
Can the lessons that you teach here in class, do you think they extend to like real life, like non-combat situations?
Oh yeah. Outside in the ring or wherever you want to take it, that's why I told to tell my student, that's why you guys hold pad for each other as a group or work as a team,
Yeah.
One, when you work together as a team, you have to learn your surrounding.
Oh yeah.
There's a lot of people around.
Yeah.
So when you throw kicks, you don't want to hit the next person next to you.
Mm-hmm.
Or when you spin, you might bump into somebody. So you have to watch your, you have to learn your surrounding, So it's kind of like be aware of yourself and your surrounding. That's outside. That's just
the
only name for the gym. Or when you jump in the ring, you have to be aware of your opponent that's going to try to knock your head
of
off,
course.
Right? So if you train to fight in the ring, it's still going to help you outside the ring because you know you're not supposed to use it outside the ring. But you will use it as a self-defense. you know, to protect yourself. I have a guy that he got in a fight at the club, which I told him, don't be going to the club too much. He ended up beating up the guy. But I told him, you can't hit nobody when you're on the ground, because then it takes to a whole different new level where you can be charged for assault when somebody's on the ground, you know?
What about like non-combat situations though? Do you think it helps out maybe kids at school or something, or people working anyway?
Yep, it does, because...
Has it helped you?
It helped me a lot. Being a martial artist or Muay Thai, Muay Lao, to learn the art and to learn how violent you people would call it, you know, punching is violent, kicking is violent, but to understand what violent is, you don't want to use it on nobody. You know yourself. You well disciplined. You know that you have a weapon that you can't use on somebody.
Interesting.
You know?
Yeah.
As I have Brandon, who's just a champ here, Brandon Wong Tong Kam. He's a champ here. He's my little nerd.
Yeah.
Smallest guy ever. And you seen him, he was at the fight.
Yeah.
He can pack a punch. This kid, his friend's kind of overweight, over heavy set kid. Mm. Big kid. Almost your height. Brandon's about your shoulder.
Yeah.
He was protecting that kid from getting jumped by three other kids.
Oh.
And I was proud of him. He told me, he's like, I didn't want to do it, but he already planned it out, who's going to do what. So he knows, you know.
Very aware.
Be aware of himself. He's aware. Honor and loyalty and respect his friendship, you know?
Yeah.
And he knows how to protect his friends and who's there was surrounding him, you know?
Yeah.
So, as for kid, if the parents really like keep their kid into it, it will make them a great person. Because they would know, you know, like Brandon and Sean, my nephew Sean, they're a bunch of little goofball. They don't see like these kids go around just because they know how to fight, they try to look for a fight, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They don't. These kids have like 20 to 30 plus fight already. They know how it feels to be in a fight. Why are they gonna go outside get in a fight for? You know?
Yeah.
So they know, and they made these kids humble.
Interesting.
If you were to hang with these kids, you'd be like, you wouldn't even tell they do Muay Thai. Huh. You wouldn't even notice, you know? I've seen a lot of kids, like I said, there's not a bad kid. It's just the coach.
Teacher, yeah.
Just the teacher, how you're going to lead him to be a good person, you know? Like, as for me, I try my best to lead him to protect himself instead of going around looking for fight. Because fight's going to be there if you're looking for it.
Yeah.
If you're looking for it, it's going to be out there waiting for you. But the thing is, to avoid fight is the best thing, you know? To avoid fight, that's the best fighting skills that you need to learn, you know? You don't have to.
Yeah.
Beat up nobody to prove a point, you know? So, I mean, as for me, a lot of student here, you will see a lot of them comes in, they work for the doctor's office, work around the nurses, state worker, most of the time, army, you know? And you see these people like coming from like state worker and all these armies and law enforcement comes through here, you won't even tell they do Muay Thai, you know?
Yeah.
This girl do Muay Thai? This girl do Muay Lao? No. But when you see them kick, you're like, oh, crap.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it makes them humble. It makes them confident in themselves when they come out here, you know? So I think being a martial artist makes you really humble.
Cool.
You will see a lot of, if you ever met a lot of pro fighters, there's some very cocky, but there's some that's very deadly. And there's some that's very silent but deadly, very humble.
Yeah.
And those are the guy that you really gotta worry about. You know, the one that yap, 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 swing, swing. He might win fights here and there, but down the line he's gonna meet somebody that you think that he wouldn't beat up a, you know, he'll pick a flower and smell it and then still kick your ass, you know?
Yeah.
So it makes a lot of our guys very humble coming out here.
Awesome.
I mean, you experience firsthand how our family treats you here, you know?
Yeah, great environment here, really.
We try to keep everybody in the environment. Right now, a lot of our students on vacation, spending time with their family. That's what I always tell people first, you know? Family first, take care of your family. The gym's hopefully still gonna be here, you know? take care of your living situation, take care of your health, take care of your wife and kid first. Then when you get frustrated, come in and beat up on the bag, learn some stuff, get some sparring out, you know? And then you go home back to your family humble again.
Injuries. Have you ever had any injuries that have affected your training? And what did you do to get around them?
Like, I have injured here. I have injured my rib here. I broke my leg here.
Oh, geez.
This is being goofy. I injured myself and tried to do a side kick on a board that bounced back.
Oh.
Didn't put the board down. That's when I was young and idiot. Here is doing to getting kicked a lot, and I didn't learn how to take a kick right.
Oh.
So I kind of hurt myself. Remember I told you these are all the little tendon?
Yeah, I remember telling me that.
Tendon, small little tendon ribs here. So if you don't know how to accept the impact or know how to block it right, you will get a good Muay Thai kick or Muay Lao kick into here to where you will shitting out. Well, excuse my language, but you will be crapping out blood, you know? And that's what happened. I kind of did a little bit inter bleeding, but it heals now.
Ouch.
Here, I was training so hard, doing all this MMA workout with my buddy Ty Elliott and doing Muay Thai for a run. Like, I was, a lot of my family thought I was gonna die training, basically. Yeah, because I was training like
so often.
Every single day. They would see me leave the house by 5, won't make it home until 12.
Jeez.
Every single day, you know, so I trained so hard where I want to get good so fast. I rush myself, I guess, you know? So I was sore. And then when I go to work, I work in a metal place where you have to lift up metal.
Okay.
So it slipped and I torqued my arm.
Ouch.
So I kind of pulled a tendon. So I didn't, it was hurting. So I was like, oh, it wasn't bad. Went, did some more training, hurts more, ripped more. So I went to the doctor. I couldn't even lift up my arm.
Oh,
couldn't
geez.
Even move it. So I didn't want to stop training because I got 8 weapon, right?
Right.
2 of them's injured. So I got 6 other weapon to work with. So I guess my buddy Ty taped me up. Lefty all day, right kick, left kick, left, left, left. And my left got good.
Yeah.
I ended up knocking somebody out with my
oh,
left.
Oh, really?
Yeah, awesome. In a tournament.
Cool.
But it helps a lot. I mean, it's because my left is always my jab. That would be my weak side.
You know, uh-huh.
A lot of, it's like your left is your strong side.
Mm.
Mine would be more of my right side, my strong side. So if I can't do my strong side, I have to make this side strong as equals to this side.
I see.
So you have to learn how to switch your weapon around. If this weapon ain't sharp, you gotta sharpen it up. This weapon is sharp, you gotta switch it up, you know? So just because, as long as your leg's not broken, and the doctor tell you to sit your butt at home. I mean, your leg could be broken, but you still could be working out your arm.
Right.
With a dumbbell or something, you know? You just gotta keep your body active, you know? Because if, like, right now I just come out from a surgery, so hopefully I'll be competing again. The doctor told me not to do nothing for at least 2 months. So I'm waiting by the end of the month. So this is not an injury. This is my postponed from competition. So this is my other injury. So I don't wanna have no excuse. Now this is taken care of, and hopefully I'll be competing again. So
perfect.
Just because you got like obstacle, you know, like just because you got a little bit of injury, okay, your thumb's hurt. You got four other one.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, 4 other fingers. So you still can grab with the other one.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, just because your wrist hurt doesn't mean you can't work out your other weapon.
Yeah.
You don't stop. You know, I might be wrong, but a lot of people, like a fighter, a person that likes to work out, they won't stop.
Right.
They'll just keep on going.
Keep
like,
going.
You know what? Wrist don't work? Fine. I'll work this side, you know? That's how you get strong. So then you got time to pay attention to one other weapon that you're weak at. You know, if this is your strong one, this is your weak one, so this strong one's out, you got to work on this one to get stronger. So it gave me time to realize, you know, just because I'm injured in a certain spot, I still can work my other weapon.
Cool.
At least keep those weapons sharp. So maybe down the line I might need it later. You know?
Yeah.
So injure, take care of your injure, but at the same time, you got other weapon to work on.
You keep training.
You gotta keep on training. Unless you broke your leg, you can't you can't run, but then you still got your arms and, you know, do something with it, you know?
Did you keep training after with your broken leg, or did you?
I had to hop around with this leg, but you know, I didn't really train. They won't let me train, so
yeah,
it's kind of.
I was gonna say a broken leg.
Well,
tough.
I still gotta walk around and try to keep my body move, you know.
Yeah.
But
of course.
Other than that, it heals back pretty good. So.
So, AK, what advice do you have for maybe some less experienced martial artists or some aspiring martial artists out there?
Well, I would say, man, go. Don't be closed-minded. You know, be open-minded. Go out there, learn something. Whatever works for you, that's for you. You know, like Bruce Lee, he knows how to do MMA, small gloves. You know, that's worked for him, right? But there's nobody that's gonna be taught by Bruce Lee and still fight like Bruce Lee.
That's true.
Nobody can be like. Go to boxing and expecting to be like Mayweather or Ali the Great, you know? Nobody's gonna be like him. There's no. Why? Because those guys train all day long and to perfect their skills every single. So don't stop training, you know? Just go out there, learn what you can, be open-minded. I would say think outside the box. I mean, be a square is good, but be a circle around, you know? know a lot of different stuff, because one of those times you're gonna have to pull those weapon out and use it.
Yeah.
You don't know when you're gonna need it, you know?
Huh, I like that.
Yeah, you don't know when you're gonna need those weapons, so you have to sharpen up your weapon as much as you can. You gotta have your mind. You have to find a new way to trick. You got a new way to, you know, fight. You gotta hit angles different. So my suggestion is practice, practice, practice. For me, when I came in, after work, I'm tired as hell. Lifting metals all day, you know, moving metal around, programming, running the machines. And that's like a workout for like all day, 8 hours, 6 hours, maybe in 12 hours, you know? And I come in the gym, I'm burned out, you know? But once I start jump roping, let's get some cup of sweats
get
in,
into it.
And there we go, get into it. You have to fight. Be a fighter, to be a martial artist, it's very self-motivated. You have to do what you love. You have to do it if you like it. If not, then you might as well take dance class or something, you know?
Yeah.
Or go skateboarding or ski. If you like to learn how to fight, or at least learn the martial art to defend yourself and pass on to your kid, do it because you want to do it, because you love the art. Feel that you have to have it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I can go 24 hours fitness. Not to say there's something wrong with 24 hour fitness. I like your guys' gym, but you can go out there and lift weights.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of guys that like to see themselves look good, you know? That's what motivates them, because they want a nice, toned, ripped body, you know? Yeah. I don't know why they do it. I mean, I would do it too, to get good. But if you want to be a martial artist, you have to do it because you have passion for it. You know, you have to do it because you want to learn. You want to know, you know?
Yeah.
Because if you don't, then that's not me. You know, there's, I seen, you know how many people come through here?
Probably a lot.
Someday it'd be like 20 people. Someday it'd be 30 people. Sometimes it's too much for a lady. And sometimes there's only one out of 10 ladies would love to learn the art.
Oh, really?
That's art.
Not very many.
Not very many. Well, you see some of our girls. There's only a handful. And I have so many females come through here. I would say hundreds.
Wow.
This year, probably more than 100.
Wow.
Alone. And then they're scared, they get intimidated because they don't know what the art is. They don't know what this fighting is for. Why are they training to fight? Why are they so violent? That's because they're stopping themselves of knowing here, you know? Oh, it looks so violent, I don't want. But down the line, that's why I try to tell my sister, because my sister's an Iraq veteran of war, and my other sister, you know? I have two sisters. So for me as an older brother, I have to teach them to learn how to protect themselves, you know?
Yeah.
And then my brother fights, I have to teach him how to protect himself, you know, because then I don't have to worry. As a parent also myself, I have a daughter, so I'm passing on the knowledge. I'm passing on, if you're not doing it because you want to fight, at least doing it to learn the knowledge so you can protect yourself against something else.
Yeah.
Or somebody.
So we can
at least you can pass it on to your kid. You don't have to get them in the gym once you learn the art already. Once you are fully trained and you know everything, you already compete a couple of times in the fight world, not even have to be pro.
Yeah.
As long as you can compete a couple of times to understand how it feels to get hit and when, you know,
yeah,
all that environment. You gotta understand all that stuff. Once you understand all that stuff, you can pass that knowledge to your kid. And once your kid has it, you feel more safe.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, look at the world today.
Scary.
It's scary as hell. I mean, sorry. It's scary like crazy. I mean, like right now, I'm still worried about my nephew Ryan bike, but I know there's nobody's gonna bully him.
Yeah.
I know that for a fact, you know. So is my brother. I know nobody's gonna bully them. So is all the student that comes through here. I know there's nobody's gonna pick on them because they know some that those other guys not know, you know, which is know how to fight.
Yeah.
Know how to protect themselves. So that's why I said at least if you're not competing, at least do it for yourself because you love it and then because you want to learn more about it, you know?
Yeah.
And pass it on to your next generation. That's what Muay Thai and Muay Lao is about. We always try to pass on to the next generation. Keep it going. Keep it continuing. You got to do it because you love the sport. You got to do it because you love the culture. You got to do it because you love the real, you know,
yeah,
everything. Everything is real that will help you in the real world, you know? There's a lot of things I can say, but there's a lot of type of word that wouldn't come out correctly sometimes, you know? But it's hard to express myself, or it's kind of hard to express a lot of feeling, you know?
Of course.
Because as for me, as a father and a brother and a friend, and, you know, people look up to me, which is I don't want them to look up to me. I want them to be right beside me, you know, known. And I always want to help them out, make sure all the student here gets the best of knowledge that they can. You know, if there's something I don't understand or I'm not specialized in it, I will recommend them go somewhere, you know?
Yeah.
If I'm not good with my boxing because of my hands, because a lot of time, Muay Thai, Muay Lao, we don't have that much of good at the hand skills.
I see.
The elbow is very sharp, but when we punch you hard, you know?
Uh-huh.
Knees very sharp.
Yeah.
Kicks very powerful. Hands, not so much lately. You know, now it's blooming. Now we kind of like, hey, we got to get our hand skill together, you know? So a lot of times, that's why I say, if I'm not specialized in hand skill, which is boxing, I would recommend people to go take some boxing class or recommend a coach that I know, you know? Like Brandon, his hands is weak. His power is his kick. He's a little kid. His kick will hurt a kid and make him cry. The last tournament that he did a while back, he fought two kids.
Oh, really?
One kid got knocked out by a knee to the chest. This knocked to the head. Boom, boom, the kid rushed him. He just said, boom.
Wow.
Done. Next kid got knocked out by a right hand.
Oh, a tough little kid.
Yeah, and I felt bad for the place where he was coming. But you know, like I said, if you teach your kid, teach people the realness of what it is, you know, tell them what it is. You know, maybe people shouldn't be afraid and scared of it, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
Because a lot of people get intimidated by our art because they think it's violent. Which it's not. It got a lot of humble behind it. It has culture behind it. It has not religion, because Muay Thai and Muay Lao is not a religion. So it's more of a culture, more of a heritage, more of a the way of our people live, you know, the way
right. We
pass it on.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So I know that Muay Lao and Muay Thai are really similar. Is the little dance that you do beforehand different in Muay Lao and Muay Thai?
The one from my teacher is different from a lot of Muay Lao that's back home in the country. And Muay Thai, there's totally a lot of different dance.
There's several of them.
Yeah, there's several dance. I can't even show you all of it, you know, because I didn't train with all the different coaches. Because a lot of gym, they had their own signature dance.
Oh,
the
really?
Dance is representing, passed on to by their teacher, you know, to pay respect to their coach, to pay respect to their teacher, to pay respect to their team, their whoever taught them. That's the dance.
Okay.
It's called Y Crew. It means like to pay respect to
Y Crew.
Yeah. Y Crew or Lam Muay. Lam Muay is a dance, yeah. It's for you to get ready for your battle. At the same time, pay the respect to your ajahn, your teacher, your master, you know? And symbolize his form of fighting. You know?
Yeah.
Kind of, if I do this, and this, you know what gym he's from.
I see.
If you do this and dance a certain way, you know what gym he's from. So it's kind of like their signature dance move from their teacher that's passed on to them, you know?
I see.
And a lot of Y Crew, a lot of Muay Lao, or sometimes a lot of the fighters will add their own little style to it.
Oh, yeah?
Like little twist to it and stuff like that. Which is, it's cool, you know? Like you see Boa Kao, he'll do the bone arrow. He'll take out the bone and he'll shoot you with the arrow. You know?
Yeah.
Some other fighter, they'll probably throw spears at you. One of my friends, he's talking about, he said, if I do the Y Crew next time, I'm going to grab a grenade and throw it out there. Which is kind of funny, you know?
Funny.
It's like a modern day warrior, you know? And there's the beautiful dance, you know, which is, you know, put powder on your face, comb your hair, you're getting ready to dress up for war, you know? You put your armor on, you sharpen your knife when they do this, you know?
Hmm.
And you sharpen up your bow arrow and you put it, you know, them aren't representing what they're gonna do for war and stuff like that. It's to represent their team and at the same time respect their master, their ajahn, you know?
Okay, well, cool.
But once they do a lot, then they can add their own little twist to it, then that'll be theirs. So when they become a teacher, they can show that side of their teachers, Muay Lao or Y Crew, and you can tell your own, and then your student would do your Y Crew. That means he's gonna do he's pay respect to you, you know? So it's passed on. But basically, Y Crew, a lot of amateurs, sometimes they just keep it basic. You know, pay respect, ready for war, stuff like that.
Cool.
Yeah. My teacher, they're a little bit different. It's more like a dance, like I kind of tell you, here's more like saying a god, one of God from the heavens coming down for war, so he's flying down. You know, and then it represents our dance. So when we dance, I mean, we ready for war, you know?
Yeah.
Dance for the war, let's go, time to go, you know? Kind of like
cool.
That. It's a little bit different from everybody, but like I said, everybody has their Y Crew, they have their Lam Muay from their own teacher. So it's been passed on from their teacher to the next, you know? I've seen a lot of Y Crew, which is, it's good, you know? You'll feel like, oh, this about to go down, you know? He's really, you know? And it gets you goosebumps sometimes, you know, when you watch them do it. And it's very traditional. It's not a religion, it's their culture. It's just the way they're preparing themselves here for battle, you know? At the same time, saying, getting a blessing from their teacher, you know, showing respect to their teacher, stuff like that.
Well, very cool.
Yeah.
Well, AK, thank you so much for your time.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much for chatting with me. Again, thank you for letting me come and train with you guys as well.
Man, anytime.
Absolutely phenomenal experience.
Anytime. I try my best to explain everything to you guys, but sometimes my word might not come out correctly. So I apologize to a lot of people. Maybe, hopefully I don't offend nobody, you know? Like I said, anybody more welcome to come out here, you know. We try our best to show you guys a little bit of something different. Because being different is the way it's the best, you know. You don't want to be the same, then everybody's the robot.
Yeah. If I'm ever in Sacramento again, I'll definitely stop by.
Oh, yeah?
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Do that, so.
Yeah.